Welcome. I'm joined here today by Jaco Lok, who is a senior lecturer in the School of Management at the Australian School of Business and an expert in the area of power and influence. Jaco, thank you very much for speaking with me today.
Sure.
Jaco, what are some of the latest research and groundbreaking findings in regard to the topic of power and influence?
Well, I noticed that in your text you pay quite a bit of attention to Pfeffer and Pfeffer's paper on power and politics. And the reason that paper is so important in the field of power and politics is because he was the first to signal how all-pervasive politics and power and the use of power in organizations actually is, and that it's not necessarily something that is to be seen as negative. Prior to that paper, both practitioners and researchers tended to think of politics as something that's negative. It was all about the Machiavellian backstabbing stuff that ultimately could only hurt the productivity of organizations. Pfeffer's paper made us realize that actually it's a necessary part of effective leadership, the use of power. It depends a lot on how you define it, and I'll go into that a little bit later. But following from that paper, a lot of work has been done in the area of influence. And when I talk to my students about influence, they can easily see that influence is necessary to get things done. It's all pervasive in organizations. Yet when you say, well, but isn't influence the same as politics, they often look puzzled. And so a lot of the recent research is in the area of influence. It's about negotiations, it's about persuasion skills and things like that. And sometimes I get the question, well, why is that politics? If you define politics as nothing but the conscious use of influence, and then it's perhaps easier to see how politics is all pervasive. And with conscious, I just mean an awareness of where this person that you're trying to persuade is coming from, what agenda they're following in relation to your own agenda. And also an awareness of what is the best way to influence this person given that agenda and given who this person knows, where this person is positioned in the organization. In a way, what you're doing there is thinking through the sources of power of that person and the sources of power of myself, and then thinking of the best, most effective tactic for influencing that person. So this is how research has really progressed in this area, thinking of power and politics much more as a neutral or positive part of effective leadership. And if you think about leadership, the most striking definition that I've come across is just getting things done through other people. And in order to get things done through other people, you need to be able to move whoever you want to influence from A to B. And if you have no sources of power at your disposal, so no charisma to influence them, no formal authority to influence them, it becomes very difficult to lead because you're not able to move a person from A to B. You'll need to tap into some sources of power to be effective as a leader. So that's really where research has been progressing over the past few years.
Jaco, what are some of the practical implications for leaders and managers of some of the concepts that you talked about and that are covered in this unit?
Thinking through the sources of power is actually really important and really practical. It may look like a formal list, like we can think of many formal lists of types of power, but let me give you a concrete example of how different sources of power are relevant in everyday interactions in organizations. When I used to work in strategy consulting, I often had to deal with IT departments because obviously IT systems are going to be involved in major strategic changes. And often, as consultants, we were not necessarily the IT experts. So we would approach the IT organization saying, you know, this is a major strategic initiative, change initiative that we're working on. We would like some of the core IT systems to be changed to support that. And the response you would often get is, well, no, we can't do it. Or, yes, we can do it, but we can only touch our IT systems, especially the operational ones, once every 6 months. We have a two-week window because we cannot just allow people to change our operational systems on a daily basis. It's too dangerous. And so you're faced with a dilemma. Do we wait 6 months? Well, you're in a hurry, and you've been sent by the CEO to get this done within 3 months. So what do you do? Usually what you do is the first option is to say, well, we've been sent by the CEO, so you rely on formal authority as a source of power. And so we can get an exception to that rule. Please go and call the CEO yourself if you need to. We really need to get this done within 3 months. And so you can see that the IT department's reliance on the power that procedure gives you, formal procedures, such as one can only touch the system once every 6 months, can be overruled by a different source of power, in this case, formal authority. However, the IT department can counter that and saying, okay, well, fine, you've got an exception, but what you're asking us to do is impossible, technically. It's crazy. You can't do that, especially not in 3 months. Impossible. And so they're relying on expertise as a source of power, which you don't necessarily have, to again push back on this. And you could say, well, this is clearly Machiavellian, counterproductive. Not necessarily. If the IT department is driven by, for example, a lack of resources, remember that they have a lot of projects that they're working on. Yours is just one of them. And so you will need to convince them that yours is actually important enough to be fitted into their priority list and actually be put at the top of it. And you can understand that they would need some convincing, especially if they're actually genuinely convinced that technically this is going to be a challenge. And so your challenge is then to say, okay, well, how can I overcome that as a source of power? How do I find out what drives their agenda? And usually the most effective way is not just to ask them, because you're unlikely to get a straight answer, but at least to build some informal relations into that department to ask them what's going on here. Why is the head of your department actually blocking this? And very quickly you'll find out what the problem is. And often in those kinds of exchanges, you'll find that the formal game can be quite easily circumvented through informal solutions. So, such as, for example, over lunch, you can discuss what you really need to get done within the next 3 months. And if you get to know them, you'll often hear, well, oh, is that what you want? Well, that's quite easy, actually. We can do a temporary fix on an Excel sheet over here. And then in 6 months' time, we'll do the formal stuff, but at least you've got a temporary workaround. And we'll deal with the formal stuff later. So you can see in a very concrete example how sources of power can shift in quite a dynamic way, and effective politics consists of finding out what drives them, what agenda, what's driving their behavior, what motivates them, what you need to get done, and then finding an effective influencing tactic to get that done. And that really is, to me, what effective leadership is about, and politics is integral to that.
Jaco, thank you very much for talking to me today.
Great, no problem.